Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second night of the convention. And tonight we have a great program lined up for you. We have an authors panel of science fiction authors and even science factual authors in some cases too. And then we have a movie presentation on Mars in the movies over the last 100 years that will follow on from this. So to get things warmed up a little bit, do you realize how many pieces of science fiction involve Mars? Literally hundreds. It's over 100 by now. So, there's a pop quiz. See how many of these you can name. I don't know if the panel can see the screen or not, but... Can you turn the volume up a bit?
No one could have dreamed we were being scrutinized as someone with a microscope studies creatures that swarm and multiply in a drop of water. Few men even considered the possibility of life on other planets. And yet, across the gulf of space, minds immeasurably superior to ours regarded this Earth with envious eyes. And slowly and surely, they drew their plans against us.
We'll be right back.
Midnight on the 12th of August, a huge mass of luminous gas erupted from Mars and sped towards Earth. Across 200 million miles of void, invisibly hurtling towards us, came the first of the missiles that were to bring so much calamity to Earth. As I watched, there was another jet of gas. It was another missile, starting on its way. That's how it was for the next 10 nights. A flare spurting out from Mars, bright green, drawing a green mist behind it, a beautiful but somehow disturbing sight. Ogilvy, the astronomer, assured me we were in no danger. He was convinced there could be no living thing on that remote, forbidding planet.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
Then came the night the first missile approached Earth. It was thought to be an ordinary fallen star, but next day there was a huge crater in the middle of the common, and Ogilvy came to examine what lay there. A cylinder, 30 yards across, glowing hot, with faint sounds of movement coming from within. Suddenly the top began moving, rotating, unscrewing, and Ogilvy feared there was a man inside trying to escape. He rushed to the cylinder, but the intense heat stopped him before he could burn himself on the metal.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. Chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come. Yes, the chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. Chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
See, we didn't manage to get everything.
That's the 10th Doctor, you know, that's different.
I know, it's terrible, isn't it? Oh, dear me. There's no way that we could cover every single one, and Jessica is my production manager in the Philippines, and she did most of the research from that, and she's interested in space. I was going to have her on the internet over Skype, but unfortunately she's still asleep, so it's 6 o'clock in the morning over there, 7 o'clock in the morning. Well, I want to talk very quickly about the last four slides and how significant they are. This one, of course, is from the 2005 War of the Worlds, and basically it is how we can use science fiction to grab people's imaginations here on Earth. And that's what it's all about. Science fiction can pull us into the future, whatever future the science fiction authors want us to go into. So that's the purpose of that slide. And this was an interesting one. This is the book that I got for Christmas 1972, just after Apollo 17. And this is the very book. And the artwork, I'll try and go backwards. If you notice there's something subtly wrong about that picture, other than the fact that that's a Martian base that NASA planned to have on Mars in 1982. Well, that's wrong, unfortunately. But can you spot the Martian mistake? The sky is blue. Yes, that was before we knew the sky was pink. But it was corrected in later versions of the book, so the artist told me. And then, of course, the biggest, longest-running science fiction novel in history is NASA's Budget. And it's currently in its 50-something edition.
It's actually horror, not science
fiction. Okay. Science horror, yes. Thank you, Doctor. That's quite true. And I'm sure somewhere in those pages it mentions missions to Mars, but I don't think so. Unfortunately. And of course, everybody's favorite Martian, Marvin. And he's had his sights set on Earth for over 50 years now.
It obstructs my view of Venus.
That's right. What is it? The Pew? What is it? The number?
Plutonium Cube 36 Explosive Space Modulator.
Of course, somebody would know. It's none other than one of our authors over here. Thank you very much. And what's the name of his dog, by the way? Canine? That's quite appropriate. I like the dog better than Marvin. So, I was going to wear my Marvin the Martian underwear today, but I decided to save you of that pleasure. So, we have a very distinguished panel put together tonight, and we have our very own doctor here. This is a photograph that none of you have seen before because I took it in 2008 at one of the conferences, and not even the good doctor's seen it. So the rest of them I pulled off the web, including the picture of me. That's an interesting shot of Jeff. And unfortunately, I couldn't match Mary, but that's pretty good. She's holding a book, and she looks very authorish. And then David in interesting garb that we all know and love. Yes.
And when the hat starts to fall down over your eyes, I discovered that you can sort of push your head back against the back of the helmet and kind of scrape the hat back over.
That explains the lack of hair on top now, right?
Got a full head of hair for this mission. Yeah.
And then there's me pointing to something or other. By the way, in case you don't know me, you know all these guys because they've all spoken in front of you before. I'm David Haslam, and I'm a publisher with HMSI Publishing, and I'm also an author from the author panel last year, but I'm just moderating tonight after waffling on for the last 10 minutes. Tonight we're going to open it up to the floor a little bit later, and I want to get the impressions of the authors on different subjects. And the reason David is first, he's the only one who's seen these five questions, so this will allow the other three authors to ruminate while David talks about them. But first of all, what is the importance of science fiction? So David, in about 3 minutes or so, could you tell what your opinion of the importance of science fiction? And pass the mic down.
Well, the importance of science fiction is, of course, that science fiction is not about the future. It's never been about the future. Science fiction is about the present. Not all science fiction is set in the future, but even the ones that are, really the question is, how can we apply scientific principles, scientific knowledge, our ideas about what life is going to be like in future places and other spaces, to what is life like here on Earth? I think that science fiction is preferable to mimetic or mundane.